is Ali Ahmed from University of Sherbrooke. He is a postdoctoral fellow, just completed his PhD. He will talk about concrete filled FRP tubes.
Hello everyone, my name is Ahmed Ali, I am from Sherbrooke University, and today I am going to present a research project under the title of Composite Action of Circular Concrete Filled FRP Tubes Under Cyclic Loads. The outline of my presentation contains the following topics. I will start by briefly introduction, followed by research motivation and objectives, then the experimental program and the experimental result, and finally, the conclusions and recommendation for future work. Concrete filled FRP tubes, CFFT, have several advantages, like the FRP tube serves as lightweight permanent formwork, provides longitudinal and transverse reinforcement. The FRP tube confines the concrete core, which increases the strength, stiffness, and ductility of the CFFT members. Also, CFFT members have high resistance to harsh environmental condition, where the FRP tube surrounds the concrete, which gives the FRP tube high resistance to harsh environmental condition, protect the concrete from the deterioration, protect the steel from the corrosion, and this make CFFT members have longer life and require low maintenance. All this advantage gives CFFT members the ability to be the ideal candidate to replace the conventional reinforced concrete members in the harsh environmental condition like what we have here in North America. This advantage gives CFFT members the ability to be used as bridges, girders, bridges, columns, poles, piles in marine structures and overhead sign structures. All design codes and guidelines required full bond between the reinforcement and the concrete. And as you can see in the conventional reinforced concrete members, the steel rebar is embedded into the concrete core. In addition, the rough surface of the rebar makes a bond between the concrete and the steel rebar is full bond and work as full composite action between the reinforcement and the concrete. In the CFFT case, the tube is surrounding the concrete, not embedded into it. In addition, the smooth surface of the tube makes the bond between the tube and the concrete more weaker. So the bond between the reinforcement and the reinforcement and the concrete have a significant effect on the strain distribution over the cross section. Let's see in the conventional reinforced concrete section case, we have linear strain distribution over the cross section. And in this case, we have neutral axis. This neutral axis divided the section into two parts, tension zone and compression zone. While in the unbonded CFFT member case, we will have two strain distribution, one for the tube and one for the concrete. And that means each element is performing individually. The tube are performing individual and the concrete performing individual. And this decreases the strength and the stiffness of the CFFT members. The previous researcher in CFFT domain captured slippage at the end of the CFFT member. And they reported that this slippage decreases the strength and the stiffness of the CFFT member. That means if we observe the slippage at the end of the CFFT member, that means we have full debond between the CFFT, between the FRP tube and the concrete core. Along the height, we have full debond. But if we did not capture slippage at the end of the CFFT member, that's not mean we have full composite action between the tube and the concrete. Let's go more in depth in this point. Let's say we have CFFT column embedded into a rigid reinforced concrete footing and subjected to lateral load as shown. The debonding between the tube and the concrete will occur first at the maximum moment zone, then propagate along the height of the CFFT member until the end zone. At the end zone, we'll have slippage due to the debonding, and you will have other parameters. These parameters may constrain this slippage. The friction between the FRP tube and the concrete core along the parameter and the height of the CFFT members. Also, presence of the internal reinforcement may constrain this slippage. So we might have local debonding at the maximum moment zone, and we cannot capture slippage at the end of the CFFT member. Critically, we need another technique rather than observe the slippage at the end of the CFFT member to evaluate the composite action between the FRP tube and the concrete core. This research proposed a new technique to evaluate the composite action between the FRP tube and the concrete core. This technique is depending on measuring the strain, compressive strain inside the concrete at point one using embedded strain gauge. This embedded strain gauge is installed inside the concrete at point one. And we will measure the strain, the compressive strain outside on the tube surface at point two and three. If we have the same value inside the concrete and outside the concrete, that means we have full composite action between the concrete and the FRP tube. Other than this, we will have full debonding between the FRP tube and the concrete core. So the objective of this study is to investigate the effect of the interfacial bond between the concrete core and the FRP tube on the flexural behavior of CFFT members, to investigate the size effect of the concrete core on the interfacial bond between the concrete core and the FRP tube, to evaluate the performance of using sand coating as a bond enhancer to enhance the bond between the FRP tube and the concrete core. Three different materials were used in this experimental program. The first one is the FRP tube. Circular glass fiber reinforced polymer GFRP pultruded tubes was manufactured by Creative Pultrusion Company, were used in this experimental program. Two sizes of tube were used, C12 and C16. The tube C12 has outer diameter of 12 inch, 305 millimeter, while the tube C16 has external diameter of 406 millimeter. All tubes have the same thickness, 12.7 half inch, and this is the mechanical properties of the tubes. The second material is concrete, ready mixed normal strength concrete with target compressive strength of 35 megapascal were used to fill the FRP tube. And third material is reinforcing bar. Reinforcing bar were used to reinforce the concrete footing. The test specimen is consisted of CFFT column fixed to a rigid reinforced concrete footing as shown and embedded into the footing with this distance and subjected to lateral cyclic load. As you can see, we have four full-scale specimens, C12, C12S, C16, C16S. The first two specimens, C12 and C12S, have the same diameter and filled with the same concrete, the same fiber reinforcement ratio, the same shear span, embedded 500 millimeter into the footing, and the same footing dimension. The difference between these two specimens is the specimen C12S has sand coating on its interior surface to enhance the bond between the concrete and the tube. Also, the third specimen and the fourth specimen, C16 and C16S, have the same diameter, filled with the same concrete, fiber reinforcement ratio, shear span, and embedded 600 millimeter into the footing. The difference also is the specimen C16S has sand coating on its interior surface. The preparation of the specimen. The preparation started by the sand coating process. We did this sand coating process at our laboratory in Sherbrooke University. The sand coating process began by applying an epoxy resin layer into the interior surface of the tube, as shown here by using bent ruler. And after that, this epoxy layer resin covered by coarse silica sand as shown. The exterior surface of the embedded part into the concrete footing was covered by sand coating to enhance the bond between the footing and the column. All specimens were applied to a constant temperature, 60 degree, in the curing room for 3 days to ensure the full curing of the resin. And this photo shows a view inside the FRP tube after the sand coating. Second step is the installation of the embedded strain gauges. The embedded strain gauges were attached to steel holders. The main object of these steel holders to arrange and align the interior strain gauges in its position. So this strain gauges attached to the steel holders and all this system was inserted to the bottom end of the tube as shown in photo 2 and photo number 3. This photo shows the view inside the tube after the sand coating and the installation of internal strain gauges. Heavy reinforced steel gauges with central void was manufactured to be able to insert the CFFT column into the footing without making any holes on the FRP tube. This is the formwork. And this is the casting process of the specimens. All specimens were tested under the shown test setup, and this setup is consisted of two rigid steel frames, and these two rigid steel frames are connected together by two rigid steel beams. This rigid steel beam serving as lateral guide system to prevent the out-of-plane movement of the column. The 500 kN actuator attached to the main frame, and the main frame was supported by four steel members to prevent the movement of the frame. The footing was attached to the laboratory floor using high-strength Dudek bar. And this is the real photo for this setup. Steel heads was manufactured to transfer the load from the actuator to the specimen. As you can see, each steel head has four plastic high-strength plastic cylinders. These plastic cylinders were in direct contact with the lateral guide beams and covered with grease to minimize the friction between the steel head and the lateral guide beams. This plan shows a layout of the instrumentation. As you can see, we have six sections. We installed electrical strain gauges on six sections to be able to capture all the behavior and all the strain on the plastic hinge zone for the two specimens. And each section has the following strains, electrical strain gauges. As you can see, we have two electrical strain gauges at the same line with the internal strain gauges to be able to compare the strain inside the concrete with the strain outside on the tube surface. If we have the same strain inside and outside, that means we have composite action. If we have different strain inside than outside, that means we have the bonding between the FRP tube and the concrete core. And we capture the slippage between the FRP tube and the concrete core using two potentiometer at the top of the column, and we capture the lateral displacement of the column using these potentiometers, and we used one potentiometer to capture any slippage of the footing. The instrumentation of the plastic hinge zone, as you can see here, we measure the slippage between the footing and the column using two LVDTs and two potentiometer to capture the curvature of the column at the plastic hinge zone. The next video shows the failure of the specimen seat wall. As shown, the failure of the specimen C12 occurred suddenly as due to the compression failure of the tube, as shown in these two photos, while the failure of the specimen C12S occurred due to vertical cracks in the cube and then compression failure of the tube wall. The test was completed and the load was reversed to the other direction, which applied tension on this tube surface, which led to full rupture of the tube. Also, we capture fine cracks at the top surface of the two specimens, C12 and C12S. While specimen C16 and C16S suffer from excessive slippage between the column and the footing, as you can see, this is the level of the footing, and now we have this level, and we have also spalling of the concrete cover, as you can see, for the two specimens. The hysteretic response of the two specimens, C12 and C12S, showed idle flexure loop until the failure of the specimen, where, as you can see, the specimen C12 achieved 205 kN, while C12S achieved 255, which higher than C12 by 24%. The failure load of the specimen C12 was 224, which less than C12S by 14%. The maximum load achieved in the bowling direction by C12 was 227, while C12S achieved 272, which higher than C12 by 20%. While for the specimen C16, achieved idle flexure loops until top displacement of 60 millimeter, as you can see, idle flexure loops. The first cycle of 80 millimeter, we have suddenly drop accord due to the starting of slippage between the FRP tube and the footing. And followed by idle flexure loops, as you can see, we don't have any small changing in the slope of the response. But another drop occurred at the first cycle of 420 millimeter due to the excessive slippage, as you can see, excessive slippage between the column and the footing and the spalling of the concrete cover, and followed by ideal flexure loop until the failure of the specimen. Specimen C16S showed ideal flexure loop also until top displacement of 60 millimeter. But as you can see, the width of the cycle is very small than the previous cycles. At the first cycle of minus 80 millimeter, we have sudden drop occurred here at this cycle. But we can observe here, as you can see, the maximum load recorded in the next cycle of 80 millimeter is less than the load recorded at the cycle of 60 millimeter. That means we have lost a lot of strength and a lot of stiffness. And we expect that occurred due to the debonding between the FRP tube and the concrete core. And followed by flexure loops, ideal flexure loops until the top displacement of first cycle 140 due to the spalling of the concrete cover as shown, and followed by ideal flexure loops until another drop occurred at the first cycle of 80 millimeter due to the crushing of the concrete around the column. Also, we have here spalling of the concrete cover as shown until the failure of the specimen occurred due to the cracking of the tube as shown. This graph represents the envelope load displacement response for all the specimen. We applied each cycle two times, the first cycle and the second cycle, called the first cycle and the second repeated run. The second run, the recorded load in the second run was less than the recorded load as the first run. This attributed to the stiffness degradation of the columns. When we apply cycle and another cycle, we will have loss in the stiffness. This is the stiffness degradation. As you can see here, the specimen will stand the coating C12 and C12S, one in the blue and one in the green. The stiffness with sandy coating exhibited stiffness higher than the specimen without sandy coating, and the failure load was higher than the specimen without sandy coating. We can observe here a very important note. The failure load of the specimen without sandy coating is approximately equal to the failure load of the capacity of the empty tube. If we have empty tube, the failure load is approximately equal to the specimen with concrete filled. That means we eliminate the utility of filling the FRP tube with concrete. So we can conclude that also the specimen with sand coating C16S and specimen C16, the specimen with sand coating exhibits stiffness higher than, and after that, we lost the full bond between the FRP tube and the concrete core, and we have the bonding at this point. We capture this as a response, as a hysteresis response. And after that, we have the same stiffness, and the failure load also of the two specimens is approximately equal to the empty tube, the capacity of the empty tube. Now we are going to compare the strain inside the concrete with the strain outside the concrete. As you can see, we have three sections. Section at height of 0.5 the diameter, and section at 1.5 the diameter, and section at 2.5 the diameter. For the specimen, the small diameter without sand coating, as you can see in the tension, we cannot compare in the tension the strain in the concrete and the strain in the tube. Concrete will cracking, and we cannot compare the strain inside with outside. The only way we can do is to compare the compressive strain inside with outside. As you can see for the specimen without sand coating, the concrete behave as unconfining concrete, as you can see, and it's not compatible with the tube. They are incompatible together. For the specimen with sand coating with the small diameter, here we have compatibility between the interior strain and the exterior strain. The response is approximately identical for the concrete and the FRP tube. For the specimen, the bigger diameter without sand coating, the concrete behave also as unconfining concrete while the tube is linear and they are not compatible. For the specimen C16S, we have compatibility until this point. As you can see, concrete is compatible with the tube until this point. And this point can explain we have the bonding between the tube and the concrete at this point. So this result was repeated in section number 2 at height of 1.5 the diameter, and section number 3 at height of 2.5 the diameter. We have the same result. For the first specimen, we have incompatibility. For this specimen, we have compatibility. Incompatibility, we have partially compatibility. For the specimen C12S, we have full composite action, and this was confirmed by the comparison between the interior strain gauge and the exterior strain gauge, and also by the hysteretic response. Also, we can add another confirmation for our results. Okay, we cut the tube, and we see, when we cut the tube, we can see some of the concrete core are stacking to the FRP tube. That's mean after the failure, we have some of the concrete still stacking to the FRP tube. That's mean we have full bond after the failure. For the specimen C16S, which achieved partially composite action, the sand coating is stacking to the concrete core. And now the failure occurred at the interface between the sand in the resin layer. And this confirmed by the comparison between the interior strain gauges and the exterior strain gauges. For the specimen C12 and C16, we have incompatibility and we have debonding. This debonding might occur before the testing due to the shrinkage of the concrete. So now I am going to the conclusions. Failure of all columns was detected by FRP tube rupture at the column base on the compression side due to the compression failure of the FRP tube wall. The slippage of the columns out the footing was significantly observed for the specimen with 406 millimeter. Increasing the column size decreased the interfacial bond. In addition, the interface gap might be generated on the contact surface between the concrete core and the FRP tube due to the shrinkage of the concrete. Absence of the interfacial bond between the FRP tube and its concrete core reduced the flexure strength stiffness of column. The flexure strength of the CFFT column without sand coating was approximately equal to the flexure capacity of the empty tube. For future work, we are going to investigate the size more in the size effect from 100 millimeter up to 1000 millimeter to determine the bond strength between the FRP tube and the concrete core, develop a method to measure the interfacial gap between the FRP tube and the concrete core, and using non-shrinkable concrete or expansive concrete. Thank you.